soul, some brightly burning, some dark and cold. There is a
Sabbath. Abide in me, and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine. No more can ye except ye abide in me. I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me ye can do nothing. Let us pray. In fact, let us repeat our mission that is on the screen. We worship in mission, from the pulpit to the pew. We activate our mission to share the good news of Christ and his soon return. We will share it with every member in our community by ministering to their mental, physical, spiritual, and emotional needs. This is our call to mission. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we are so thankful that we could be here this morning. Lord, you have invited us to meet with you, and so we are here, and we know you are here also to worship with us. We pray that you will help us, O Lord, to humble ourselves, make ourselves available so that you can mold us and fashion us and prepare us for your soon coming. We invite your presence to be here with us. Please accept our worship and our praise. For Jesus' sake, amen. Please be- be seated. I want to take this opportunity to welcome all of our visiting friends. We are honored, you know, we are blessed to have you worshiping with us. I mean, you could have been anywhere, you know, at this moment, but you chose to worship with us, and we are so thankful. We are grateful, and we deem ourselves privileged to have you worshiping with us. The Lord is here, and I pray that whatever blessing that you may seek today, that you know, the Lord will give it to you, and that you will be blessed. If there's anything that we can do to make your worship more comfortable today, we ask that you would, don't be afraid to ask. You can say, oh, Pastor, you know, talk to our ushers, and they would be glad to help. And those who are worshiping, you know, online, we wish you were here also, but we are glad that you're still worshiping with us. And especially to our members, without you, we wouldn't have service. And so we are happy that you're here, and we pray that you also would receive the blessings that you are really looking for. So have a wonderful Sabbath, and we pray that at the end of the service, we all could say that we have been with the Lord. Thank you for coming, and have a blessed Sabbath. Thank you, Pastor.
Thank you so much, Elder Easton. We appreciate that so much. Good morning and happy Sabbath, everybody. It's a great day to be in the house of God today. It's a great day to be amongst the land of the living. And we just thank God for his mercy and his grace towards us. This morning, we're going to dive right into the announcements. As is my custom when I come during this time, we're going to begin with reminding you about the worship room on Sabbath mornings and Tuesday evenings. And I believe that there's going to be a small shift, and we'll get that information soon as it comes. But right now, we're worshiping Sabbath mornings and on Tuesday evenings, as you see there, as the screen will project in just a second. All right, there we go. All right, and we're going to go right on to prayer meeting on Wednesday evenings. This Wednesday, we met here at the church due to our meeting here, but then we're going to go right back next week to our regularly scheduled prayer meeting, Wednesday evening at 7 p.m. I want to remind you to come back this afternoon. Come back this afternoon at 7 p.m. We invite you to come back and join us as we wrap up the series here. We will be speaking on the subject, Building for Eternity. Building for Eternity. So we want to invite you to come back with us, hang out with us, and see what the Lord has to say through us at 7 p.m. On next Sabbath, April 20th, third Sabbath, we will have LAA Academy Day, Education Day, that is, and the theme is Ever Faithful, Ever Faithful. Our speaker will be Pastor Drake Barber. Drake Barber will come by and share a word with us on next Sabbath. So please make sure you invite someone to come and celebrate with us on Education Day. Also later on that afternoon, join LAA and the LAYM team, who will partner together in an evening of praise. Nationally known 11th Hour Choir from Fletcher Academy will be with us at 6:30 p.m. on next Sabbath evening. So make sure, we're going to try to get you out of here, to get you back, so that you can worship with us at 6:30. All right, 6:30 p.m. On next Sunday, as we have been announcing, there's going to be a memorial for Sister Darlene Jones, the daughter of Elder D.M. Jones, Elder former pastor of this church. So we will have a memorial for her next Sunday morning at 11 a.m. Also, on the 27th of April, Join us in for Health Ministries Day. They will celebrate sharing the health message, More in 24, which is our theme for this year, More in 24. Dr. Paula Jacobs-Fox will be with us on that day, so make sure you're here on April 27th. And then on that evening at 8:30 p.m. that evening, come out for some food, some fun, relax, you know, sit back, relax, bring your games. It's going to be a fun night. Every now and then, it's all right to come aside and rest a while. All of life does not have to be serious. We can come aside and laugh and get to know one another just a little bit more. So we want you to come out on that evening at 8:30 p.m. to be with us, right? 8:30 p.m. to be with us, April 27th. And then on May 4th, the following week, it is a spring recital. It is a spring recital sponsored by our music department. So make sure that you're here to celebrate with us on May 4th. And now we go right to our April birthdays. We start with Sister Roxanne Stevens, who's not here with us, but she's still one of ours. And so she will celebrate on tomorrow, on the 14th. Happy birthday, Sister Stevens. Then we have Brother Garth Anthony, who will also celebrate on the 17th also. Happy birthday, my brother. Happy birthday. And then we have a trio that's coming up on next Sabbath this week. We have Brother Marcus Larry. We have our very own here, Michael McFarlane, and Sister Beverly Booknight. All belong to us. All right. And also, there's one more, isn't it? Yes, Brother Ian. Yes, that's correct. Brother Ian is also going to be celebrating. So there's a quad, right? Yeah. So we have a quad next week, April 20th. So happy birthday to each and every one of you who will celebrate on next Sabbath on the 20th. We do have some anniversaries coming up here. We told you on last Sabbath about the groceries anniversary. Brother Oral and Sister Tipti Drummond, you know about the groceries. Now, I made a request. I made a request on last Sabbath. I don't know, but we'll talk about that later, okay? The groceries, I'm sorry? Amen. That's right, my request was breakfast for her. Amen, groceries anniversary. So they celebrate 44 years. Certainly happy anniversary on today to the two of you. Happy anniversary to the two of you. Also we have coming up on the 16th is Brother Milton and Kareem Nosworthy. Now some of you may not know them, but they've been coming here and coming with us. And so we're gonna ask them if they would stand, if you just let us see who you are. Amen. Might I say Elder Nosworthy? I'm gonna say it that way, all right? So we know who he is. Welcome, thank you so much for joining and being with us. And happy anniversary to you. Celebrating 24 big ones. And it is called the Opal Anniversary. And it represents wisdom, stability, and love. So happy 24th. We also have Brother Brian and Rhonda Perry, who will also celebrate this coming week. They will celebrate 14 big ones. It is called the Ivory Anniversary. It is symbolized by an elephant, okay? By an elephant. And it represents stability, patience, and dignity. Stability, patience, and dignity. So happy anniversary to you all. Amen. And may God bless each of you with many more of your anniversaries. Our quote for today, if there is one work more important than another, it is that getting our publications before the public, thus leading them to search the scriptures. All right, if there's one work more important than another, it is that getting of our publications before the public, thus leading them to the scriptures. May God richly bless you and keep you. Thank you so much.
Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
It's time for praise and worship. The Bible says where two or three are gathered in my name, the Spirit of the Lord is there, right? I am with you. What does that mean? What does in his name mean? You guys can say it if you want. In his name. What does that mean?
Speaking of the name in his presence.
About him. Just saying his name. I'm really just saying it because I really don't hear you guys, so I'm just saying things that I think you're saying. But I was reading and it says to, in his name, meaning like his life, his mission, his journey, what he did for us, dying on the cross for us, everything. There's so much that hangs on the name of Jesus. So much that hangs on the name of Jesus. And today we want to sing about that name. Amen.
What a beautiful name.
God, we thank you so much for that name, Lord, that powerful name of Jesus. So I had to come a little closer to you guys. But I feel like, you know, the closer I am, the better, you know, we worship together. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
are everything. Your name is everything.
You're everything to me.
You're everything.
children. I'm looking for you. Come on down. Let's sing. Jesus loves the little children. Again, everyone, especially the children. Good morning, children.
Good morning.
Let's say that one more time because I didn't hear everyone. Good morning.
Good morning.
That's so much better. I have some pictures today, and if you know what this is, please don't say it. Children, anyone recognize what this could be? Okay. Well, here's another one. Everyone? Anyone recognize this? What do you think it could be? They're all the same. One's just older. The first picture is the very first one. And then it became that. What about this one? How do you know it's a telephone? What makes you think it's a telephone? The second one? Oh, you think that one's a telephone? Well, what about this one? I gave you a hint a minute ago. I said they're all the same. So what is this one? Say it again. Yeah, say it out loud. It's a telephone. These are kind of old. They're older than me, older than your parents, older than a pastor. Now look at this one. This one looks a little bit more familiar, maybe. Okay, it's a telephone. Okay, let me keep going. I have two more pictures to show you. Yeah, you know what this one is. He said this is like one of the phones on the wall back in the day. We don't have to admit whether we know what this is or not, or we've seen them. And what about these? Yeah. Okay, so what did we use this for? Anyone know?
To call.
To call? What do you mean by call? Like, hey, how are you? Is that what you did with it?
No.
Well, what did you do? Okay, you're right. Okay, so there has to be a particular number, right? Well, what's this? Yes, this is my iPhone. Now, what do I do with it? Oh, play games on it? Okay. What else can I do on this phone? Okay, Brielle. To unlock it, I can use my finger. You're right. I can use my thumb. Okay, yes. We can type the number in. Zara? Okay, this is a cell phone. And the brand, the company that made this one is called Apple. And they call it an iPhone. I don't know why it's an iPhone, but this is what it is, okay? Now, if I needed to call Pastor Williams, what do I do with this? Okay, but, okay, Pastor Williams.
No.
No? You said call him. Okay, well, how do I call him on the phone? Okay, Amelia, what would I do if I want to talk to Pastor Williams using my cell phone? Oh, speak louder so everyone can hear you. Okay, she said I would scroll down and find his name and then press the green button. Brielle? That's important. I have to know his name and I have to know his number. Now, what if I know his name but I don't have his number? Will I be able to call him? Okay, so now what's important about this? It's no good if it's not what? Now let's move over. Thank you. If it's not charged. Now, sometimes adults, I'm saying adults because I don't think any of you have your own cell phone yet. Okay. This cord, that's right, to charge it up so that it's always ready. Now, this is the cord that I would use at home. I plug it into the wall, and I plug this part into my phone. And this one I would use in my car. Now, why should I have so many charging cords? Cords. So the idea is to keep it charged all the time, right? Pastor Williams, I need your help for a minute. Okay, I need everyone to be very quiet. Be quiet for just a minute. You ready? You put it to your ear. One more time. Well, I have a microphone on, so you might be hearing what I'm saying. Okay. Thank you. No, we're not going to try it. This is sort of like a toy. You can make it yourself. And if you stretch this cord really tight, and one person holds it to their ear, and the other person can speak into it, and if you say something, and if I had made this cord longer, so that Pastor Williams would be all the way over there, he should be able to hear what I'm saying. It's because we're connected, right? We're connected, and that's why he could hear, hopefully, what I was going to say. So we've learned that you have to have your phone charged, or otherwise it's not working. Now I know you'll recognize these. These are tablets, and why do I have a cord connected to it? Yes, Peyton? To charge it. Because if I wanted to play a game on this, or anything, I wouldn't be able to do it unless it's charged. Now, yes, sir. Okay, thank you. Okay, now. I want you to do an exercise with me. I want you to hold your breath and see how long you can hold it. Ready? One, two, three, go. You can stop holding it now. Now, I know none of us, none of us would be able to hold our breath very long because we need air into our bodies, into our lungs, and that's our connection with breathing. Now, just like we need a connection with breathing, our devices, whether it's a cell phone or a regular telephone at home, or those things all need to be charged. And there's another connection that I want us all to have. We need to be connected to Jesus. Jesus doesn't have a cell phone. We don't put if you put Jesus in your cell phone and scroll down, you probably wouldn't find his name or a number next to his name. His number is J-E-S-U-S, himself, Jesus. And the connection is that we need to be connected with Jesus through prayer and through studying our Bibles. So if we're not connected, we're not going to work properly. Just like all of our things here, if they're not connected, they don't work properly. So be connected through the Bible, through studying your Sabbath school lesson, reading your Bible, talking with your parents, talking with your pastor and other leaders of the church. And they will help you to figure out how you can be connected to Jesus. Prayer is the most important thing that we can ever do, and that's the way we are connected to Jesus. So, I need a volunteer who will pray for me today. Okay, well, Noah and Alex. You want to go first? Who's first? You ready? Okay, stand up. Go ahead and speak. Hi, Joey. Do you want to pray also, Joey? Okay. Go ahead, Noah.
Dear Father, thank you for everyone that have a safe day. Hope they can get back easily. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Joey, do you want to pray? Okay. Go ahead and pray. Okay, Joey, go ahead and pray. Okay, dear Jesus, thank you for this day. Amen. Okay.
Thank you, Jesus, for this day. Keep us safe while we're driving home after church, and keep us safe forever, and we're going to stay connected to you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. Okay, so I want you to remember, when you get a bucket, to spread out throughout the entire church.
Happy Sabbath. Blind, but now I was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fear relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed.
My chains are gone.
As suggested by the combined offering plan. In that case, 50 to 60% should support the missionary work of our local church. 20 to 30% will support the regional missionary endeavors of your conference. And 20% will always support the World Missionary Fund, or World Budget. This fund provides for about 400 missionary families around the world, plus some 1,600 global mission pioneers. It is also from the World Missionary Fund that missionaries and mission activities are supported among the 13 world divisions, plus the Middle East, North Africa Union Mission, the Chinese Union Mission, the Ukrainian Union Conference, and the Israel Field, which are attached fields to the General Conference. Other parts of the World Missionary Fund support several church institutions that prepare missionaries for the World Church, like Loma Linda University, Andrews University, Adventist International Institute of Advanced Studies, and Adventist University of Africa. This fund also supports Adventist World Radio and Hope Channel's outreach work in the Humanitarian Ministry of ADRA, the Adventist Development and Relief Agency. As a result, millions of people from different cultures and backgrounds have recently found salvation in Jesus and have joined the Seventh-day Adventist Church family. A recent study suggests that every 22 seconds, someone becomes a Seventh-day Adventist, and a new church is established in the world every 4 hours. Thanks to our offerings and the global mission focus, thousands of new congregations have been established in previously unreached areas and among new people groups. However, after these new believers have been baptized, how are they nurtured? Part of our promise offerings also provides resources that help to disciple and care for the new members of our church family, teaching and guiding them so they can also become a source of hope for others. As you return your tithe and promise, regular and systematic offerings, remember that you are part of a flowing river current that that helps grow and sustain mission work equitably, locally, regionally, and globally. May we put our desires last and God first. A new year is starting, and Jesus is coming very soon. What will you do this year to participate in his end time mission? You may help advance the establishment of his kingdom through your prayers, working for others, and tithes and regular offerings. By the way, have you ever wondered what happens to your promise offerings? Think of your offerings as a vital river flowing through the entire world, providing life-giving support to build God's work in every mission field, locally, regionally, and internationally. But exactly where do our offerings go? What do they achieve? And what do they support? Suppose your regular and systematic offerings, which we call promise offerings, are distributed as suggested by the combined offering plan. In that case, 50 to 60% should support the missionary work of our local church. 20 to 30% will support the regional missionary endeavors of your conference. And 20% will always support the World Missionary Fund, or World Budget. This fund provides for
I was not surprised at the reactions of those this week when the news went out that the juice, O.J. Simpson, had passed. There are people who are still, from 1995, still carrying around this level of hatred in their hearts. And yes, there were a lot of things that were tied to this verdict, tied to this case. But to know that there are people who are still walking around with this hatred in their heart, it is sickening. And my prayer was that I hope that none of these people profess Christ as their Lord and Savior. Because we serve a God, and whether we like them or not, whether we had our own opinions, and we all have, we serve a God who has, number one, no respect of persons. And number two, the Bible reminds us in Romans chapter 2 and verse 11 to stomp out prejudice. It has no place, it has no business in the life of a child of God. I thought CNN would go through the whole trial. And that's media's way of manipulating the situation and painting it and having it lean in a certain direction so that people will see it that way. I thank God we serve a God who loves his people enough that regardless of what we have done, he still loves us. And he would do anything, as I reminded you this week, would do anything to help save us. And the greatest thing that he's ever done was he sent his son, Jesus Christ, to die on this cross so that we may have an opportunity to live in eternity. Right now, I want to invite you to come to the altar to bring your cares and your concerns, the things that you want to bring to God. I shared with you on last evening that David in Psalm 63, in the heat of the battle, in the moments of pressure, he began to praise God. He didn't complain, he didn't murmur. He started praising God with his lips. And what I wanted to add to that is the fact that he didn't go asking for anything. He just began to praise and to thank God for his loving kindness. And so today as you come, we're asking you to pray silently, as I soon prepare to pray aloud. My prayer, preserve my life. our Father, our God. Once again, Lord, we thank you so much for another opportunity to come into your house of worship and praise. God, we thank you for what has transpired here thus far. The beautiful songs, the word, and God, the fact that we are all here this morning. Father, you woke us up this morning with the intended purpose of us being in this place where we are able to worship you in truth and in spirit. We come, God, because you're such an awesome God. You're such a worthy God, and you're worthy of our praise today. And God, we come this morning no less than to lift you up because of how gracious and how merciful you have been to us as your children. God, while we're here today, Lord, I just want to lift up the entire church, every person under the sound of my voice, every family that is represented here today. Father, we know the enemy is busy. We know that he desires to sift us as wheat. But God, we know that you are God who loves us more than anything else. And Lord, when that enemy comes in and tries to sift us, God, we pray that you will somehow come in and sweep him out of the way. God, he has no business and no place and no purpose in our lives, only to destroy and to seek, kill, and to destroy. God, I'm amazed that we live in a world that is still carrying hatred and prejudices from nearly 30 years ago. God, regardless of how we felt, regardless of our opinion, he is still your son. And Father, we pray that our hearts and our minds will soften, will tender, and that those hearts that are not turned towards you will find their resting place in you. Lord, today we come with a multitude of concerns and cares and thanksgivings because of all you have been to us. God, right now I just want to lift up Sister Harrison's mother, who was admitted to the hospital and we're told that she's in critical condition. God, I pray that you're already there visiting, but I'm asking that you go by. And Lord, touch her body right now. God, I pray that you will touch her in such a way, Lord, that she know that she has been touched by you. May she feel your presence, God. Manifest yourself to her right now. God, we know that you are God who knows how to answer prayer. God, we know that you are God who cares and loves your people. And so, Father, we pray that you will go by and touch her right now, Lord, and fill her with your spirit and your power. Invigorate her, Lord. Revive her. Bring her back, Lord, to the place of normalcy. God, be with her family right now. I'm sure that there's concerns about her condition and how she will turn out. But, God, you know what? We're going to leave her in your hands. Because, God, we know that you know best, God, and you're going to take care of her. So, Father, we pray that you bless her mightily. Return her to normalcy. So, God, there will be a testimony about how gracious you were to her. God, this morning I want to lift up Brother Larry, who will be deployed, I believe, next week. Father, he's your manservant. He's your son. And, Father, I pray that as he goes out and to protect this country, Lord, that you will watch over him and that you will keep him during the time of his deployment. God, we pray for him who has been serving this country in a mighty way. And sometimes, God, that comes across as a thankless job. But God, we thank you for him. Thank you for putting his life on the line. And even for others who have served in the military and those who have deployed. I continue to lift up my son who's there. Continue to watch over him, Lord, and keep him safe. And Father, we pray that as he's gone, that you would protect his family. Lord, that you would keep them in safe and somehow help them to remain in contact as he's away. Father, I pray most of all that you be with us. We're here today. Father, those who are sick, those who are not feeling well, those who stand in the need of spiritual nourishment, those who are having financial difficulties, God, those who need you, regardless of what our circumstances, God, it all boils down to the fact that we need you. We need you, God, to come into our lives from an individual basis, Lord, and take charge. Although you don't force us, God, you encourage us to allow you to come in and do a mighty work. God, we lift up our marriages here, Lord. We lift up our children. We lift up our school. We lift up our departmental leaders of this church. And God, we pray today that as we bring a word from on high, Lord, that somebody in this place will come and ask the question, what must I do to have eternal life? God, we've been preaching decision-making all week long, and somebody has to make a decision. Somebody needs to make a decision for you, oh God. This is more in 24. We don't have time anymore. It's time to stop playing and delaying, because time is running out. So God, as the word goes forth today, may some soul be encouraged to take their stand, to make that walk down the aisle, to say, God, I want to give it all over to you. I want you as my Lord and Savior. I want to live a life with you in the kingdom. Father, we pray for those who are traveling who are not with us here right now. Bless them in a mighty way. Father, we pray that you will continue to guide us and lead us. Bless the rest of this service. And may your name continue to be uplifted and praised. And may you pour out your blessings upon this place. And Father, if I fail in asking for anything, please don't fail in granting. Because we ask all these things in the mighty name of Jesus. And God, remember the prayer box for those who have placed in request. Lord, answer those prayers according to your holy will. And answer all the prayers who have come and the concerns that have come down to the altar, even for those that are unspoken, those who remain in their seats today. For we ask all these things in your name. Amen and amen.
Oh,
Can the church say amen? Amen, amen. We thank God so much for what has transpired here on today. We thank God for our musicians here. Amen, amen. For our praise team who's dressed in their Kelly Green today. Amen, somebody. And we thank God for the Sergeant Sisters. Amen. I don't know why I want to call you the trio for some reason. I don't know why. But the sisters, I will work with that. Thank you so much for the beautiful music. We appreciate you so much. Thank you. Thank you so very much. We are here. This is 6 or 7 messages that we will present to you. Again, we want to invite you back this evening at 7 p.m. as we talk about building for eternity. Building for eternity. if you have missed a message this week, I encourage you to go back and look at it. There are some things that God wants us to know. And particularly for those who have not given their hearts to God. I know somebody in here is in that category. I know they are. And God wants you to give your heart to him. He wants you to give your life to him before it is too late. Don't play around. Don't delay. Don't do anything that will put yourself in jeopardy of missing out on the greatest opportunity that we could ever have. And that is to live an eternity with Jesus Christ. And so, again, we thank you so much for being with us today. Today we're going to be looking at a subject. Matter of fact, go ahead and stand with me. Go ahead and stand with me. We are going to go right to the word, Luke, the Gospel of Luke, the Gospel of Luke. We're going to go to chapter 17, the Gospel of Luke, chapter 17. And if you've missed out, you've missed out on some wonderful quiz questions. We have a professor of quizzes every night, and he's been challenging us. And so we appreciate Elder Amsterdam and what he's doing through the quizzes. Luke chapter 17, Luke chapter 17. Can we bring that up? Luke 17, verses 11 through 19. Luke 17, 11 through 19. Here we go. Let's read together. Let's read together. The Bible reads, "And it came to pass as he went to Jerusalem that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. And as he entered into a certain village, there met him 10 men that were lepers, which stood afar off. And they lifted up their voices and said, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. And when he saw them, he said to them, Go show yourselves unto the priest. And it came to pass that as they went, they were cleansed. And one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back and with a loud voice glorified God, and fell down in his face and at his feet, giving him thanks, and he was a Samaritan. And Jesus answering said, Were there not 10 cleansed? But where are the 9? Two more, verse 18 and 19. There are not around that return to give glory to God, save this stranger. And he said unto them, Arise, go thy way, thy faith hath made thee whole. From the clear word, it says, as Jesus went toward Jerusalem, he walked along the border between Samaria and Galilee. As he approached a certain village, 10 lepers came to meet him, stopped some distance away, and called out, Master, have mercy on us. Jesus could see their leprosy and simply said, Go, show yourselves to the priest. They left on their way, and they were healed. One of them, when he saw that he was healed, ran back to Jesus, praising God as loudly as he could. He fell on his knees, bowed to the ground, and thanked Jesus for what he had done for him. And he was a Samaritan. Jesus asked, Weren't there 10 of you healed? Where are the other 9? Verse 18, Did not one from Israel come back to praise God? Then he said, Get up and be on your way. Your faith in me has made it possible for you to be healed. The tenth man, let us pray. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for this opportunity now to share this message with thy people. Father, I especially right now pray for another portion of your strength, that whatever comes from me, from you, will be encouraging to someone else, so much so that it will draw them closer to Jesus Christ. We thank you for the example that you shown by your life. And now may we exemplify this through your word, because you are so worthy. We thank you now and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. The story is told of a man who got lost in the woods. And later on, while describing his experience, he explained how frightened he was about being lost, and he finally decided that he was going to kneel down and pray. And someone asked the question, Did God answer your prayer? And he says, Oh no, the man replied. Before God had a chance to answer, a guide came along and showed me the way out. Like that man, many people are blind to the blessings of God that he daily showers upon them. They awake in the morning to the sunshine and do not wait to give God thanks. They hear the birds chirping and they see the flowers and the beautiful scenery outside, but they don't give a moment's thought that God has given them those blessings and given them those things to enjoy. They grumble about having to eat some old cereal, forgetting that many would gladly exchange places with them who have nothing to eat for breakfast. They complain about their jobs, forgetting that many would be grateful just to have a job or even have the bodily strength to go to work. They complain about their lack of money, forgetting that they spend more on entertainment each month than many around the world can earn as their total income for the year. And so whether you are a believer in Jesus Christ or a person who does not even believe in God at all, the fact is God has blessed you far more than you realize and more than you deserve. It's important to understand how to respond to God in a proper way, to respond to him properly regarding his abundant blessings. To the oblivious, to the fact that God is blessing you, or even worse, to take credit for his blessings, and if you earn them by your own efforts, would be to slight God. The only proper response is to glorify him from a thankful heart. Two responses that we're going to deal with in the text today. And this has to do with one that is proper, and then there's one that is improper. And the question is, what is your response? Is it a proper response, or is it an improper response? Our text quickly takes us to Luke chapter 17, where Jesus began. Well, in verse 19, that is. I'm going to start at the bottom and work my way up. And Jesus answering and said, where are there not 10 cleansed, but where are the 9? Where are the 9? There are many sermons that have been preached from this text. A lot of sermons, whether they were one title or the other. A number of sermons have been preached from this text. Why? Because this text has a lot of significance. Like in the OJ trial, many things that were circling around in his trial, where there are many things that are circling around this text also. In other words, you have a few things that are going on that draw people to this text. We find that leprosy is a chronic endemic infectious disease marked by the formation of nodules, ulcerations, and deformative eruptions that impact the body. In the Bible, I want to remind you that leprosy is a dreaded disease that is a picture of sin. This is alluded in our text this morning by the fact that the lepers were cleansed. In verse 14 and 17, leprosy rendered a man ceremoniously defiled so that if he was healed, he still had to go to the priest to carry out a thorough examination of the cleansing before he could be accepted back into the community. It is also a disease of blood, and it is very repulsive to look at. William Barclay, in his Daily Study Bible series, denotes this. He says, it might begin with little nodules, which go on to ulcerate. The ulcers develop a foul discharge. The eyebrows fall out. The eyes become starring. The vocal cords become ulcerated, and the voice becomes hoarse, and the breath wheezes. The hands and feet always ulcerate. He says, slowly the sufferer becomes a mass of ulcerated growths. An average course of that kind of leprosy is 9 years, and it ends in mental decay and coma and ultimate death. He goes on to say that leprosy might begin in the loss of a sensation in some part of the body. The nerve trunks are affected. The muscles waste away. The tendons contract until the hands are like claws. There follows ulcerations of the hands and the feet. Then comes the progressive loss of fingers and toes until in the end, a whole hand or a whole foot may drop off. The duration of that kind of leprosy is anything from 20 to 30 years. It is a kind of terrible progression, death, in which man dies by the inches. Lepers in this society were those who were isolated, and they made known their condition by a wailing voice. In other words, whenever a leper would come unto you, he had to warn you. He had to let you know that he was a leper or that he had a disease. While the physical disease was horrible, what was more horrible was the terrible social consequences that were in Israel to add to the misery. According to Josephus, lepers were treated as if they were in effect dead men. The Mosaic law prescribed that a person be cut off from society, including his family. He had to wear torn clothing and have his head uncovered, covered his lips, and shout, unclean, unclean, whenever he went to warn others to keep their distance. This was the law of the land. In Bible times, back in the book of Leviticus, chapter 13 and verse 45, this was considered to be a plague of the day. Our text indicates this morning that the affliction brings a common level, brings us all to a common level. Now, the Bible says that all 10 of the men were unclean, and regardless of their situation that they may have been facing in life before their sickness, here is an example of the great law of life. A common misfortune had broken down the racial and the national barriers. In common tragedy, we're told that their leprosy, they had forgotten that they were Jews and Samaritans and remembered only that they were men in need. If you've ever seen animals, horses in particular, whenever there is an oncoming flood or some kind of storm that happens, you tend to see these animals move and rush toward higher ground. And what tends to happen is that those animals that are moving towards higher ground, they go there and they gather together. And what's interesting is that the animals that would normally kill one another, all of a sudden now are gathering together for survival. This was the situation there. You had Samaritans and you had Jews gathered together, and you all know that they did not get along, dating all the way back to Jacob. They were isolated and made them dangerous to society, the lepers. What was the worst on those days? Their condition was hopeless unless God interposed. The Bible wants us to know and to see ourselves in that natural state before Christ as spiritual lepers in his sight. God wants us to see that our hearts are deceitful and desperately sick, sick with sin, unclean before a holy God. Furthermore, just as this awful disease of leprosy separated the leper from the community, so sin causes distance and rupture in the human relations, often among family members. And just as only God can heal this dreaded disease, so only God can heal and cleanse the human heart from this awful disease of sin. You know, there are those who are proud, and the proud refusal to acknowledge our true condition as spiritual lepers is one of the main reasons people do not receive God's salvation in Jesus Christ. We are all prone to say, I may have faults after all, I'm only human, but I'm not a terrible sinner. I'm basically a good person. That's what the Pharisees said about themselves, and they missed God as Savior. Indeed, who needs a Savior if you're basically a good person, right? That's what the lukewarm church in Laodicea thought when they said to themselves, we are rich and increased with goods, and we have no need of anything. To think that you are basically okay in God's sight is a surefire way to receive nothing from him. If these lepers had thought, we may be sick, but we're not that bad, they would have cried out to Jesus for mercy. They knew that they were goners unless God and his power had mercy on them. You know, leprosy, in this case, is depicted as those who have sin in their life. And it is so with also sin in the heart. It puts all men on the same level and all sinners by nature on the same level. Sin does what? It defiles the body. It defiles the soul. It defiles the spirit within. Sin separates us from God. And our text shows us this. A sinner outside of Christ is a hopeless person. Sensing they're a deep need of faith, here's their case right here. Among other things, leprosy attacked the vocal cords so that these men probably could only make a raspy sound in the beginning, but that didn't stop them from raising their voices and crying, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. This gracious Lord Jesus will never turn a deaf ear to a cry like that. These men knew Jesus by name, but they also called him Master, according to the text, acknowledging his authority. Luke is the only gospel that used this word addressing Jesus, and every other time the word master is used by the disciples. In uttering this cry, Jesus, and these lepers, they take their proper place, rather, under the lordship and the sovereignty and his authority. And we must put him in the proper place as a Lord and Master when it comes to him. The lepers pleaded with Jesus, have mercy on us. Mercy, like grace, is God's undeserved favor. Grace is getting what we do not deserve, and mercy is not getting what we do deserve. Mercy also contains the thought of compassion in view of the sufferer's pitiable condition. But crying out for mercy, these men were acknowledging that they did not deserve healing. They weren't claiming we're lepers, but we're pretty good lepers. We think we are worthy of being healed. They knew that they were that there was nothing in themselves to earn healing or to commend them above others. This is the only way that we can come to God for deliverance from the leprosy of sin, is to acknowledge that we deserve God's wrath, but to appeal to his great mercy. The good news is that God delights to show mercy to those who cry out for it. He is abounding in riches and for all who call upon his name. For whoever will call upon his name shall be saved. People that have no faith in Christ will never sense their need for salvation. Here it is. Here's the cure in cooperation with Christ. It's an easy condition. Jesus tells them, he says, go and show yourselves to the priest. That was the Israel law according to Deuteronomy chapter 24 and verse 8. But it was also a difficult requirement. When Jesus healed the lepers in Luke, that leper in chapter 5 and 13, he actually touched him. He healed him first. And then he says, go and show yourself to the priest. But there, without any evidence of healing, Jesus commands these 10 lepers to go and show themselves to the priest. In this, their situation was similar to that of Naaman in Syria. When Elijah told him to go and bathe in the Jordan and dip 7 times, it was a test of faith for them to go without evidence of healing. We are told whether the lepers had a debate about whether or not to go. I can well imagine one of them saying this, well, we look like fools if we show up at the priest and our condition wasn't right. Because obviously going to the priest, you're thinking now that you have been healed and that you're ready to return to the community. But they're saying, you know what? We look like fools if we go to him and we have not yet been healed. Another counter, yes, but we've got nothing to lose. This is our only hope, but it hurts us to walk on these leprous feet. I know, but if we do what he says, maybe we'll be healed. But this isn't the way that it went. He healed other lepers also. So why doesn't he heal us the same way? I don't know why, but we must obey. They were told to express gratitude when as yet they had not been healed. They could not go by sight. They had to trust the healer. And as you know, the thing that got them healed was when God told them, he says, I need you to go. And immediately they went. And while they were on their way, they were healed. We're talking about great faith here. But when they obeyed the physician, God honored their faith. Here it is. The only condition to receive God's healing for our leprous souls is that we take him at his word. That whatever or whoever believes in the Son Jesus will not perish but have everlasting life. Just as these lepers, we're told, did not first try to clean up or make themselves presentable, so we are to come to Jesus just as we are. Just as these lepers did not just believe intellectually by faith that had obeyed Jesus' word, so we must exercise personal obedience, faith in him, with regard to the promise to save us from our sins. They all obeyed, And they all, the Bible says, were made whole. Now, according to the original language, when that one came back, the Bible says that the word whole there can be translated saved. So not only was he made whole, but he was also saved. I need you to know that God has no respecter of persons. He doesn't care whether you're black, white, rich, poor, whatever your social status is, it doesn't matter. And this is what God was sharing in this pericope. God is always willing to honor those who are faithful to him and those who will come to him by faith in Jesus Christ, regardless of your status. But only the Samaritan returned to give thanks. This is the first response. This is the sad part of the story where 10 lepers were healed, but 9 failed to express their gratitude to the healer. The thankful leper represents the full fruit of the saving faith, namely, lips that give joyful thanks to his name. The fact that this man was a Samaritan shows that this way of salvation is open to everybody who calls upon the name of Jesus. And I want to remind you that if you're sitting in this room, salvation is open to you. It doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter whether you got here late, got here early. It is open to you. Note that the leper's praise was heartful. He glorified God with a loud voice. If before his voice had been hampered by leprosy, it was free up now to exercise it with full force. Others may have been embarrassed by his exuberance, but he didn't care. When God heals you, you don't care about anything else but being healed. You don't care who sees you, who's watching you, who's around you. It doesn't matter. The thing is that you have been healed and you thank God. Those of us in this room who have been healed, all you wanted to do was to get relief from whatever your condition was. And when God gave you that relief, it did not matter to you who was around. All the pride that you previously had went out the door because you were thanking God for that relief. The leper's glad praise should be that every person whose heart has been healed by Jesus' mighty power. Twice it is mentioned in the text that the man glorified God in verse 15 and 18. To glorify God is to extol his attributes and his actions. It is to exalt him, to let others know how great he is. As the Puritans rightly stated, the chief end of man is to glorify God. That's what we're here for. And to enjoy him forever on the account of his blessings of salvation towards us who deserve his judgment. The great evangelist Spurgeon points out that while 10 men prayed, one man praised. He says that even so, there were far more who were prone to pray in a time of need than to praise God when he meets that need. Oswald Chambers, in the book Most to His Highest, some of you may have that devotional book, he says, great difficulty spiritually is to concentrate on God, and it is his blessing to make it difficult. Troubles nearly always make us look to God. His blessings are apt to make us look otherwise, or elsewhere rather. If the Lord has delivered our souls from judgment, we ought to let others know about it. And so you have 1 out of 10 who came back and expressed his gratitude to God. The Bible tells us, or a further reading reminds us, that he got down on his face, showing how gracious he was and how thankful he was that God blessed him and healed him. But then there is also the other side. The other side, an ingratitude that's marked by cold-bloodedness and indifference to the blessings of God, treating God as if though God has never done anything for you. How it must have pained the Lord to see untold thousands of people around the world who has never turned to God and to thank him for the undeserved mercies that they enjoy. Ingratitude is a curse of our age. How many meals are consumed without saying the grace? How many people wake up each day without saying, thank you, Lord, for waking me up this morning? Thank God for the 10th man who felt in his heart to return and give thanks to God who healed him. as a Samaritan who was looked down upon by the Jews because of their broken relationship. Jesus didn't care what his status was. In the text, again, words have meaning. And in the text, Jesus said, the Bible says, Samaritan. It was there for a purpose. I would have thought that he would have gotten thanks from the Jews rather than from the Samaritan. But just the opposite. And it goes to show sometimes your own countrymen, those who you think will support you, are not supporting you as you think. But thank God for the 10th man who felt in his heart to return. And yes, he was a Samaritan. Sometimes the treatment is better from the outside than from the inside. But Jesus still, in his heart of compassion, blessed this man, regardless of the racial tensions that had existed during the day. And the question I have for you really is, does your life, do our lives, represent the 9 sinners that are healed without returning to say thanks? Or does it represent the 10th man, the one who came back to give thanks, the one who offered gratitude and expression to Christ? Which one are you? Are you the 9th man, or are you one of the 9, or are you the 10th man? As I wrap this up, 13 years ago, or should I say 13 years rather, before his conversion, John Wesley had a conversation late one night with a potter of his college that deeply impressed him and convinced him that there was more to Christianity than as yet he had found. Wesley discovered that the man had only one coat and nothing that had passed his lips that day except a drink of water. And yet his heart was full of gratitude to God. And Wesley said, "You thank God when you have nothing to wear, nothing to eat, no bed to lie upon. What else do you thank God for?" The man replied, "I thank him that he has given me my life and being and a heart to love him and a desire to serve him." Those of us in this room who have known of Jesus' healing power in our souls, we live each day with thankful hearts. And I believe that others will be drawn to him. And I want to encourage you today that let's learn a lesson from this exuberant and thankful leper. Because it was something that he didn't have to do. He was one who had every excuse in the world not to go back and thank Jesus. But because he was so thankful, because he experienced, as I mentioned to you last night, the loving kindness of God, he humbled himself and bowed down and got down on his knees and on his face and began to thank God. After all that God has done for me and you, every day throughout our lives, he's brought us through sickness. He's brought us through car accidents and all kinds of things. And we're still living. Are we giving God the thanks that he deserves? Or are we treating him like the 9? We get well and we just keep walking. And for Jesus have to ask the question, where are the other 9? Just think about you. You do something not to expect appreciation, because that's not how we do it. But you actually get nothing. And you put your heart into it. You put your mind into it. And you get absolutely nothing. How would you feel? Yes, you could expect it from the person who you may not have gotten along with. Okay, all right, but I'm going to do it anyway. But they didn't come back. But the people who you expect, and neither one of them came back to say anything, was disrespectful, disgraceful, distasting, disheartening thing that one could ever do. And I pray by the grace of God that none of us in this room is like that. Many of us, God has healed us. God has brought us through. And all he's asking us to do is to say thank you. Somebody right now in this room needs to say thank you to God. Needs to say, Lord, I thank you for what you've done for me. I thank you for bringing me through that circumstance, through that situation. I thank you for healing me. While every head is bowed and every eye is closed, somebody right now in this room needs to give God a chance. And I'm down here because I'm already here to meet you when you come. I need somebody to get up out of their seats right now and come down and say, Lord, I want to give it all to you. I want to give up my life. I want to show you how much I appreciate what you have done for me. I'm going to make two appeals. This is the first one. If you're somebody who has not given your heart to God and you want to do that right now, we're just asking that you do so. Come on down the aisle. I'm already here to meet you. I'm already here. Amen. Come on down, my sister. Amen. 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 God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Stand right here. Somebody, don't let her stand by herself. I don't understand. This is the 10th person right here. Is there 11th? Is there an 11th person? She's the 10th. Is there an 11th person right now? Somebody needs to give their heart to the Lord right now. Come on down. I'm going to take my time today because I purposely cut it short just for this. We've been waiting around and messing around all of our lives. And God says, now it is time to come. There's somebody else in here. I know it is. Somebody that's in here needs to come on. Don't sit there. Come on, get up down here. Don't worry about your pride. God says the day is the now of salvation. He says the day that you hear my voice, harden not your heart and come on down. Come on down. Come on down. Stand right beside me, my sister. Somebody else in this room right now who needs to come to Jesus. This series has always been has been about decision making and prioritizing our life. It is time to prioritize. All the signs are around us. The world is letting us know that it is folding up. And we've got to make sure that we're in the ark of safety. And somebody here today is, somebody else is here is not in the ark of safety. I don't know who you are, but somebody else is here that needs to be in the ark of safety. Will you come and join these ladies right here? Will you come and join them? Don't let them stand by themselves. Don't let them stand by themselves. Come on down and give your heart to God right now, today. Today is the accepted time. Come on. Praise God. Come on. Come on. Somebody else in this room. We're not going to stop right here. We're not going to stop right here. As I shared with you all last evening, it's about decision making and prioritizing. But it's about prioritizing the right thing. And God is our priority. Somebody else needs to come. Somebody, don't let them stand here alone tonight. Let somebody else come and join them. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Nobody comes to the Father but by him. And so if we intend to get to God, we got to go through Jesus. We got to make him our choice. Those of us who are here can testify to the goodness of God and how good God has been to us and how life is so much better with Jesus. Somebody may be struggling right now, but don't struggle any longer. Go ahead and give it up. Go ahead and give it up and come on and join this family. Join this family. Come on to the ark of safety. Somebody else right now. I'm not ready to let go yet because I don't feel like letting go just yet. Just give me a few more minutes. Somebody else needs to come. Somebody else needs to come. Don't let this opportunity get by you. Don't leave here today and not giving your life to Jesus. Don't leave here. Please don't do that. One of the greatest decisions that you could ever make is to turn it all over to Jesus. Recognize him as master. Recognize him as Savior and Lord. Somebody else here this morning who says, Lord, I want to give it all over to you. Is there somebody else? Is there somebody else? I know you out there. I know you are. I know you are. Don't let this time get away. Or if you just want to come and say, Lord, I want some Bible studies or something. I want to get to know who you are. We'll get you to some Bible studies. And we'll talk about the Samaritans and the Jews and how they separated and how they hate one another and why it is still going on to this day regarding that piece of land. God says, just come to me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. You know, sometimes this life can be a tiresome life, you know. And God says, if you just come, I will give you rest. He says, I will make life light for you. He says, somebody else right now, somebody else needs to come, somebody else. Just a few more minutes, just a few more seconds here, a few more seconds. Somebody else, come on, don't let them stand alone. Somebody else needs to come. Somebody else needs to come. Somebody else needs to come. Don't wait till this afternoon. Don't wait till next week. We may not have that long. I don't like doing the scare tactic thing. That's not what this is about, but it's a reality. It's a reality. Remember those folk that got on the bridge? F and Merlin thought they were going to the other side. Didn't know that it was going down, but it went. And there were lives that were taken as a result. We don't know. We don't know. Somebody else. I'm getting ready to pray. I'm getting ready to pray. And my second appeal is this. My second appeal is very, very, very simple. If you want some Bible studies, if you want some Bible studies and you want to know more about God, this doesn't necessarily include baptism right away, but we hope for it, pray for it eventually for you. If somebody wants Bible studies, want to know more about God, I'm going to ask you to come as well. Come on down and join these ladies. Come on down and join the ladies right now. Come on down and join these ladies. Somebody else. I'm getting ready to pray, Elder. I'm getting ready to pray. I'm getting ready to pray. Somebody else, Bible studies. I'll come get you. I'll come walk you down the aisle. Just raise your hand. I'll come with you. I will walk with you. This is not the day to hold back. This is not the day to hold back. You've been holding back a long time, and it's time to let go now. Is there somebody else? We're getting ready to pray. We're getting ready to pray. And if while I'm praying that God impresses your heart, I want you to just come, okay? I want you to come. This is about decision making. This is about decision making and good decision making. Father, we thank you for the lepers, for the 10, for the 10th man, the one who decided that he wanted to go back, who recognized that God healed him and spared his life. Lord, he appreciated it so much that he said, forget about the 9. I'm going to be a Daniel. I'm going to stand alone in this case, and I'm going to go back. And I'm going to thank him for what he has done. And Father, we thank you for your life and for your example that you have set for us. God, you set forth for us. You set in motion for us to be able to spend eternity with you. Lord God, we thank you for those who have come and said, Lord, I want to give my life to you. I thank you for those who have come and said, Lord, I've heard enough. I want to make the decision to follow you all the way. And God, I still feel like that there are some others in here, but they're just not coming right now. And so God, I thank you for them and thank you for their commitment. We're reminded that all of heaven is rejoicing over one soul that comes. But Father, you've blessed us here today. And Father, we pray that you will protect them now and guide them, Lord, because the enemy is not happy with what has been experienced here. The enemy is upset right now, and he's seeking now and planning to do something evil. But God, I pray in the name of Jesus right now, before he even thinks about it, God, that you will bind him up and protect these ladies right here. Protect them in their comings and their goings. Protect their mindset, God. Protect them each and every day, oh Lord, because we know that the enemy is not happy. And Father, I pray that there's someone who needed to come but did not come, Father. I pray your blessings upon them. I pray for someone who wanted to take Bible studies but haven't decided to do so, God, that you will bless them mightily. Father, this is why we're here. This is what this thing is all about. It is coming to be encouraged so that we can give our hearts over to you. And then, Father, we pray that you will bless everyone here today. And Father, I pray that something has been said that will encourage us, has encouraged us, that has drawn us closer to you, and that will make us want to turn in the direction of you. And Father, I pray that if we're not connected, help us to get connected, and if we are, help us to remain connected. Help us to seek you daily so that when we come in contact with people, they will know that we are people of God. Our best witness is that we live, and then we begin to speak and tell others about you. We thank you, God, for hearing and answering this prayer, God, and all that you have done and all that you will do for us going forward. And let us not forget tonight as we come back, we're going to talk about building for eternity, because that's where we all want to wind up. We thank you now and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. God bless you. Share a sad note with us, and I hate to kind of leave on this note, but I didn't want to start with it before I had a chance to come up. Many of you know Pastor Marvin Brown, who was interim pastor here for a couple of years. A few years back, the word came that he passed this week, 96 years young, and so we pray for the Brown family, and we thank God for the service that he provided here at First Lithonia. Pastor Marvin Brown.
Pray. Dear God and Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy most holy and precious name. We are grateful, dear Father, for the time we have spent with you today, and we pray that you'll help us to submit ourselves to you so that you can use us and you can mold us into what you want us to be. Father, we know your coming is very, very near. And we hope and pray, Lord, that you'll help us to so prepare ourselves so that when probation closes, Lord, our names would remain written in your Lamb's Book of Life, and we can spend eternity with you. These blessings, Lord, we humbly ask in your wonderful and your precious name. Amen. Please be seated for a moment of silent reflection.